Welcome to the Red Zone's exclusive coverage of WMCQ1 2016 here in the Philippines. I'm Miguel Otleg.
And I'm Gerald Legao, and thank you for joining us at the booth. Right now, shuffling for our first quarterfinal match, we have Morris Matthew Martinez playing Grixis Control versus Adin Medina playing Green White Tokens.
Great.
So, what are your thoughts of this matchup?
I think the control player has an edge right here. But, you know, seeing that green-white has been the dominant deck for most of standard, I think this is going to be an interesting game.
Yep. Looking at the deck list, we can clearly see that the Grixis control player is well prepared for the matchup. But, we'll see.
Best of luck to these two.
So both players shuffling their decks well, coming up with the deck check. Make sure everything's random.
I heard about something about the lore. Like, they told me that zombies cannot be corrupted by the Eldrazi since they're undead already. So, Eldrazi cannot emerge from them because they don't have. Yeah, there's no life in them.
I'm not too familiar with the lore, but okay.
Oh, there we go. They're cutting right now.
Both players ready. Presenting their starting seven.
Game one is up now.
Both players checking for mulligans.
Grixis is up with a smoldering marsh. It's that.
Fortified Village, Rubies of Plains, is playing Autumn Tesla.
Xavier Villasanisa.
That's his turn.
All right, that's just the mind right here. Oh, two Gideons. Right. So in his hand are one Evolip, two Gideons, one Tragic Arrogance, one Nissa, a Canopy Vista, and a Plains.
And he has to be seeing that Alan only has two lands and must take the Nissa.
He has to be relieved right now, right? He sees a Tragic Arrogance, which is kind of dead in this matchup, right?
Yep.
If he takes the Nissa though, my mistake. Alan actually has three lands on that hand.
But he does take the Nissa. Interesting play right there. I guess that means no action till the fourth turn.
Oh, well, he actually has Evil Leap to play on turn two.
Okay, that's fair.
And he does. And passes a turn.
If he doesn't top deck a basic land, he might even go as early, the earliest as turn 5, right? So yes, he only has Canopy Vista in his hand.
Oh yeah.
And he top decks a Lamholt Pacifist.
The judge fixing our zones here, so it's clear that we have Nissa on the exile zone. Mars passes his turn without playing anything, and Alan must be thinking that he has a counter of some sort.
Well, he did play a land, though I'm not sure if it's a Smoldering or a Foreboding Ruins. That's a similar art, that I can say.
It actually says...
Oh, I think it's a Smoldering card. Alright, Gideon creates a Knight token. Call against command, I believe it's 2 damage and discard.
And discards the dead Tragic Arrogance.
Yeah, I don't think Morris realized that.
Or he just didn't have anything else to do.
Alright.
And you have other modes to choose.
Alright, it's just a destroy artifact, right? Not enchantment.
Yep.
Okay. So it seems like we're already transitioning into the mid game. Oh. What's going to be the plan for Alan going forward?
At this point, since Morris played the Jace, it's obvious that he doesn't have removal for that Gideon. So Morris might be thinking of just swinging, and he does.
Oh, here's another Nissa.
And at this point, Alan might be thinking he's way ahead of this game because he now has Nissa with the plant, Evil Leap and Evil Leap mana up. but it's still early. There are still some cards, I think, in the main deck that can do something, but it's going to be a lot of work.
So as you can see, Allen tapped with for just one green mana for that Nissa. He's able to do that because of Oath of Nissa, which states that you can cast any planeswalker even without the required color requirements.
So Morris plays Dark Petition with Spell Mastery into Ruinous Path, which gets him lets him get a card and float 3 black mana and plays Ruinous Path to destroy the Given. Now he's tapping Jace to loot a card, and this Jace will flip.
I think his plan next turn is to just destroy the other Nissa, right? Or maybe destroy the other Gideon in Allen's hand.
Yeah, that is a plan, but as he stated, Allen does have another Gideon in his hand, so that might just be too much for Morris here.
Dragon Lord Silengar. Huh. Okay, activates the evolutionary leap and finds a Hangar Backwalker. Morris checks hand size. It's now up to 4 after this draw step.
And note that Morris did discard that Dragon Lord Silengar, which signals that he doesn't have any lands in hand. So Allen must be thinking all these, I think 3 cards that he's holding, are all live cards.
It's stated at Evolip's ability that you have to randomize all the cards that's going to the bottom, right?
Yeah, so I think that's why the judge stopped them for a while. I think they had to fix the cards going to the bottom. So we're back in Allen's turn and creates another plan.
He's just up to 5 now.
Now he's thinking of either playing Gideon and baiting it for the Ruinous Path, or just playing the Hangar Backwalker. And he does play the Gideon. So he actually does that so that Morris is forced to use the Ruinous Path on the Gideon, which allows him to plus the Nissa up to 6, I believe. Because once he ultimates that Nissa, he's going to be way ahead in the game.
So as you can see on the screen, Nissa's ultimate ability, -7, states that you draw X life, you gain X life and draw X cards, where X is the number of lands you control. Right now, Morris is casting a Goblin Dark Dwellers targeting Ruinous Path and destroys the Gideon as JR has stated. quick glimpse at Morris Matthews' hand. We see a Silumgar's command, I believe, and a read the bones. So he actually has some answers for the other planeswalkers. Reveals a Sylvan advocate using evolutionary leap. Okay, so right now I'm seeing a play wherein if Alan doesn't have the 6 land, and he uses the Sylvan Advocate this turn. Morris is quickly gonna go 2-for-1 with the Silumgar's command and a Nissa.
Nissa goes to 6.
Oh, I'm sorry. I mean Silumgar's command destroying Nissa and going -3/-3 on Sylvan Advocate. I think he's going for Hunger back for 2. Oh no, he goes for a double Sylvan Advocate.
But without the land.
Yeah. Even Languish can do it here, right?
Yeah, I think we saw Alan pause there for a bit, and he must have been thinking the same. Like a board sweep would really hurt him, and he was thinking of holding up the Sylvan Advocates until he got the 6 man, but decided not to.
Actually, in my experience playing Band Company, I think the really good strategy here is to just keep Sylvan Advocate in your hand until you go up to 6 lands. That way, any black sweeper, or even red, wouldn't be that damaging to you, except if he has 2 in hand.
Yeah, what he could have done was activate Evil Leap on the plant.
Yeah.
And play the creature that he would hit.
And now we see the Silumgar's command destroying Nissa, and I think we'll go -3/-3 and Sylvan Advocate. Interesting.
Alan forgetting to activate Leap there.
Oh,
still not doing so end of turn. Huh. Now casting Hanger back Walker for 2. Well, for 4 mana, X equals 2.
Does Grixis have an answer for Ormanda?
I'm not sure. I think maybe a bounce spell is, but I don't think he has an in the deck. Okay, finally, he finally plays Read the Bones, and he's down to 13 life. Scries another Read the Bones, and not sure what the second card was. I think he bought them 3 Demons and draws Grasp and a land.
Right, so Grasp and Languish are really the tools to fight Armandel here. Seeing the board state of Alan, he's very close to actually having the right tools to have Armandel on his side.
We do know, you do need to note that he actually does not have voice mail in play yet, so that might be the reason why he's not really playing that way. And he does remember to activate the deep this time. And I believe that's an Abyssin.
Still no 6 land for Anen.
Well, he does have that Archangel Abyssin in hand, so that might come in handy.
Fair enough.
Although Morris is still at 13 life, so it's still a long way to go. So Alan's now contemplating on playing a creature or just casting Abyssin end of turn, and he does pass a turn. So looks like that's what he's doing.
Oh, so Jace is up to 9 now. Jace's ultimate states that for every spell Morris casts, Alan gets to mill the top 5 cards of his library.
So he is getting to ultimate territory here, but it might not be too relevant in this game. He does now play a Kalitas, which might hinder Alan's usage of Evil League.
From Sabasin.
Morris casts Grasp on Abyssin and gets a token out of the Kalitas. At this point, it's still hard to tell who's ahead of the game, but you have to think it's Morris now.
Only realistic way for Alan to answer Kalitas right now is decoration and stone. And I'm not sure if he has one in his hand.
He also has Tragic Arrogance in the main deck, but if you remember from earlier, that was already discarded to Cold Against Command.
Yeah, and as seen in his deck list, there's only one copy. Oh, here we go. He activates the ability of Hammer Backwalker, adding a +1/+1 counter to it. And then goes the Mokas command with the modes +1/+1 counter to Hammer Back. And then it gets to fight with Kalidas. So that way, Hammer Back doesn't die. But because of Kalidas' lifelink, Morris gets up to 16.
That's an Evolving Wilds getting a swamp. Good turn.
I think he's going for another read of this. Or a Dark Petition.
He taps 6 mana though. Oh, that Evolving Wilds was actually main phase, sorry.
In response to the Kalidas.
He believes the hanger back one. Gets 4 counters, that's 1 for each. +1/+1 counter on the hanger back.
So in this board state, Kalidas does not get a zombie token.
And gets an Abyssin off of the evil lead.
Japanese.
And he finally gets a 6 land. And Alan's still at 20 life, by the way. Considering singing with the Topters, I believe he's thinking of either going for the Jace or...
hesitates. Going for Jace right now means it goes down to 3. Which means Morris can only go for +1 if he wants more value out of it.
Well, at this point though, Morris has to think he has to either have a sweeper kill spell or he has to take down Jace and just get the use out of it.
How many creatures in the deck has Allen? Does Allen have?
Main deck? So he has 3 Lambok Pacifists, 3 Hanger Backwalkers, 4 Sylvan Advocates, and 4 Abyssins, I believe.
That's a total of around 14, right? He
And
could
he
only have that much evolutionary leap activations before he runs out of gas.
Yeah, the problem with Evil Leap in grindy games is you do actually run out of creatures.
Especially in this deck, in which its specialty is actually just making tokens. Now, Morris attacks with a Kalitax.
And he really has no reason not to attack with the Kalitas. We have a bunch of jump blockers that can block, but I doubt that Alan's gonna do that.
Here we go for a second Abyssin.
Oh,
I think.
I forgot. He does actually have an Abyssin in hand, which he showed to Evil Leap earlier. So Morris must have an answer for that.
But he does have a Zambi to sacrifice to
Kalitas.
Oh,
yeah, oh, yeah. I forgot about that.
Oh, but here's a double block. One activation doesn't really help.
I'm not sure what Morris is thinking here, because those things do have indestructible. And Kooligan's command is destroy target artifact. Wow. I'm not sure what happened there. I'm checking the text on Kooligan's command here just to see what really happened.
I think the modes that Morris chose are deal to damage to target creature or player and destroy artifact, which supposedly cannot do anything in this board state due to Abyssin.
Yeah, that factor clearly is already supposed to have indestructible, but the players just missed it, I believe.
What happens when you miss something like an indestructible ability?
I believe the that's technically a game rules violation, and if the judge saw that, he's supposed to back up until that point, because he still could. So I'm not sure if they missed it or if they will back up or what. Okay, so post-combat, Morris does use up that Jace, laying grass to kill that Abyssin.
A Lamb Hold Pacifist right here. Oh, a Declaration of Stone. Oh, this is starting to get out of hand for Morris. Now his realistic outs Actually drawing some board sweeper.
He does have Languish, which he hasn't played yet, and a Chandra Flamecaller, so that is two cards. Oh,
there's a slight problem with just having one of them.
Oh, and he also has a Radiant Flame, so three cards could actually do it.
But he only has two lands in his hand. Let's go. Now Lambolt's ready to attack. Does he have Wandering Fumeral in his board? I don't think so.
And even with a sweeper activation, with this much green mana available, Alan could just get back in the game. Swings for a lot. And Mars down to 7.
That's lethal next turn.
So realistically, he has to draw a sweeper now to buy him another turn.
Or Dark Petition.
That also works. Looking at the card, he draws another swamp and scoops.
That's it for game one.
So we have Morris with, sorry, we have Alan with Green Wine tokens up a game against in this quarterfinal match. And we'll go to game two. So we're here at game two. You want to talk about the Grixis sideboard options?
Oh yeah, sure. Looking at his decklist, he has some negates, duresses, a pick the brain, a virulent plague, and a dragonlord Silumgar. I think these are some excellent choices in battling against green and white tokens, especially virulent plague, because their primary game plan is to create tokens and win with them. And then for the negates, it can counter the planeswalkers, it could also counter Evolutionary Leap, it could also counter the Security Wastes. The rest acts the same as negate, except that it catches the spell before Alan could even cast it. Then for Dragonlord Silumgar, it acts as a 2-for-1, I guess, because it makes Alan lose his planeswalker or creature, while Morris gains one creature, as well as another body in a 3-5. Looking at his main deck, though, I think the primary options for boarding out are Colagan's Command and Chandra, seeing as they're kind of low impact in this matchup, since we know for a fact that Morris is the control player here. So Chandra's plus ability doesn't really go well, since I think in those turns, it's still kind of a catch-up game for Morris.
Okay. From the green-white side, I suppose I see Alan boarding in a fourth Hangar Backwalker and the two Dren Protectors, taking out the Lambolt Pacifist. Also, he has a second Evolutionary Leap on the side. He'll probably be boarding in some Declarations in stone, taking out a Tragic Arrogance, maybe an Abyssin or two. And what else do we have here? I think we have Dragonlord Jermoka on the sideboard as well. So the game plan, the Green White's game plan generally when going against Grixis or Black-White, these big guy control strategies is just to get on the board quick and just have removal for their big threats. So hopefully that's what Alan here would be doing. And we're already underway. This is Alan's fourth turn, I believe. Swinging in with Sylvan Advocate. Morris is already at 14 life. And Alan still at 20 with Evil Leap on the board. Okay, Runa's path on the Silver Advocate.
That is something you do not want to do as a control player. Because I think, as a control player, Morris would want to use his Ruinous Path on the Planeswalkers. Because those are the more problematic ones going forward.
I'm not sure what Alan was thinking, though. He had the mana up for Evolutionary Leap, and he considered activating it in response to Ruinous Path, but decided not to. Not sure what he was thinking there.
So as we can see, Morris has Radiant Flames as one of his board sweepers. But on Alan's side, we see that he has the Dromoka's Command, which can prevent damage from an instant or sorcery spell. Going into the game, we already see the problematic evolutionary leap for Morris right here. Going forward, Silumgor's Command and a combination of either Negate or Duress will be his only way to deal with Evolutionary Link. Or maybe what he can do is just grind it out and hope that eventually Alan would run out of gas from Evolutionary Link.
Yeah, in my experience, the problem with Evil Leap is you do eventually run out of creatures. Yep. As we counted earlier, he has 14 in the main deck. With how we think sideboarding went, he should still have around the same number, maybe a little bit less because of boarding out an Abyssin or two. So he could easily run out of gas. But so he actually needs to get on the board early he needs to get some power on the board early to deal the damage that he needs.
One issue I have with the way Alan used his mana here is that he doesn't have an untapped white source. It might not be that relevant at this stage, but it might be good practice to have mana up for both colors.
Yeah, absolutely. You would want to represent having the ability to play all your cards. So. Yeah. Morris with the Jace.
As we can see from Morris' side, he already has this Dragonlord Silumgor in his hand. Already waiting for the next Planeswalker, I guess. Or maybe waiting for the Ormondel, which is, I think, is in Alan's hand.
Alan works a Ben Protector.
In this matchup, would Morris be thinking of a Hidden Dragon Slayer, perhaps?
Well, green white doesn't normally run though, so I guess not. He does call against command the more. And of course, Alan flips to get a probably a declaration.
I think it's probably gonna get an Isa. That's an option. Or even an advocate, seeing as it's a, it can be a 4-5. But he does get the Nisa.
I would normally get the declaration though, knowing that you only have two in your deck and there's a second one. Because you have your evolutionary leap to give you constant threats. Oh, and apparently he also kept Lambo Pacifist on the deck.
See, going back to my remark, that's what happened is now Alan's not representing Dromoka's command for two turns straight because he keeps on using his white mana unnecessarily.
Yeah, if he actually had the mana up, Morris might have hesitated using the command there. But on the other hand, he might have not as well. So if he had the mana up, Morris would have waited for end of turn where Alan would be flipping the Dem Protector and then use Call Against Command there. So that's three mana that he would have not utilized properly. So yeah, he should have actually kept that white mana up.
Interesting. Going for Call Against Command to kill off a plant token and discard the Sylvan Advocate.
That's actually a very good play because it leaves Alan with no creatures on the board.
Even wasting a precious resource in a creature with a very good body late game.
Actually, well, it turns out Alan actually top decked an Abyssin and plays it on Morris's end of turn. And I believe he has something.
Gets a Dragonlord Dromoka right here. Uh-oh.
Abyssin attacks the Jace, sends it to the yard.
Right now, the problem in Morris' hand is that he has Raging Flames, and it doesn't quite do the job against a 4-4. You cast a Dark Lotus. Ooh, that's nice.
Mm-hmm. That's Dark Dwellers getting transgressed and transgressing the Dragonlord Dromoka. Abyssin swings again for 4. Morris is down to 8.
Right now, if you're Morris, would you use his Dragonlord Silumgar for the Abyssin now?
He could actually just use it, and knowing that Alan would use Leap on it, because Alan already has an Abyssin on the board, and there's no other bigger creature in yet with it. So even if he gets another creature, in exchange for the Abyssin, that's still a net gain for Morris. And he does.
Let's see what we find here. Not a Den Protector.
It's a Den Protector. That's actually... Well, it normally would be good against this matchup, since he already has one in the yard. We could potentially chain the Den Protectors. His problem would be the two big threats that already face him. You know that earlier the declaration was put on the bottom by Evolutionary Leap, and also from the last activation of Stasis Snare. So right now he should only have Stasis Snare and the declaration on the yard to deal with those two things. And if he does use the Den Protector to get that declaration, that means he won't be chaining them. So that's going to be a problem.
Right there, again. Using up all his white mana.
I am not sure what Alan here is thinking. He... Because even with Evolutionary Leap, you won't be playing the cards at instant speed, so he really should be representing the white here.
Especially that he's already shown a Stasis Snare.
Yeah, more so.
Oh, that's a spicy one. Another Dragon Lord Zilumgar for.
Oh, he got one from the top?
Yeah. Another. Planning to use a Radiant Flames. And I think it's a fine play right here. Seeing as there's no white mana in Alan's side.
Another thing that Alan could have done during his turn, though, was play the Den Protector, activate it to get the declaration, and get rid of that Dark Dwellers right away. Also, normally, though, in this matchup, the green-white deck should normally remove some of the Dromoka's commands from the main, but I personally prefer to leave one, just in case the opponent leaves a Virulent Plague, and just board in more, in case I actually see the card. It looks like with the way that Alan's been tapping his mana, that he actually boarded out everything. All four copies, but we'll see. There's one of them, so I'm not sure why he's tapping mana that way. That's two. So he might have actually kept all four copies. And now Morris swings with everything, putting Alan down to 9.
So now Alan's put into a 2-turn draw. But with Abyssin... I don't get why Lambo is still in the mansion. For aggression, maybe?
Yeah, he's probably thinking the old win against control with a lot of creature strategy. But Lambolt's clearly not a good card in this matchup. So Morris knows that there's Avacyn, so probably not be attacking this turn unless he actually has something.
And by the look of his hand, I think it's a couple of lands and a Dragonlord Silumgar.
Okay, and he does attack because of that Dragonlord Silumgar. So Alan could either block the Silumgar or mass block the Dark Dwellers, which is what he should do to get less damage in and to actually kill Dark Dwellers. Oh, but he blocks the Silumgar. And takes 4. So Morris plays the second Silumgar, stealing the Avacyn, which was obviously what he had in mind, and should be winning this game really soon.
Yeah, the way Morris attacked, he actually signaled that he was supposed to have a removal spell, but letting the indestructibility resolve from Avacyn, that just means he has another play lined up, and he's willing to just go for a card disadvantage.
Even with the removal spell in hand, if he lets Alan block the Dark Dwellers, and that's still okay. I mean, Alan still takes less damage that way. He doesn't get rid of the Dark Dwellers, but he takes one damage less. So that clearly should have been the play. Okay, so he does. So Alan plays Nissa, creating a plant, and I believe he should be passing the turn.
I believe he's out here is going for. Oh no, he only has 5 mana. He's only out here as an adversary. And it is!
He does have one.
Wow.
So he's down to 5. Morris has 2 flyers on the board and a Dark Dwellers. Attacking with everything would mean his Avacyn dying and Alan taking 2 from Dragonlord Silumgar. What Morris could do here is attack with Dark Dwellers and just let Alan do his thing with Avacyn. And if Alan decides to kill off Dark Dwellers, then he takes 3 from Avacyn during his upkeep, and that might actually be good enough. Moore is taking his time here. What do you think about Morris just swinging with everything? Again, that would put Allen down to 2.
Yeah, that would put Allen down to 2. But seeing as he's down to 8, that's kind of a risky play.
Oh yeah. Him down to 2, he would actually take 9 from the backswing. Or 10 actually, so yeah, that's not a good idea. So he passes a turn. Allen deciding not to play the Abyssin.
I think he values the indestructibility.
Yeah, what he could have done though was get another creature from the plant end of turn, I guess. But yeah, that's okay. He was trying to flip the Lambo Pacifist during upkeep, but Morris reminded him of the duress that he actually played. And now he does get to flip it. Morris looks at his hand and looks like, is that all lands?
Yeah, I think so.
Abyssin. And he's now probably realizing that he can attack with the Dark Dwellers. And he does. On Nissa though.
Well, that just could mean he could block with 2 plants and sacrifice them with Evolution. Oh.
See, what Morris is trying to do here is he's trying to provoke a block from the Lambo Pacifist's 4/4 side. I forgot what that card is called. And a plant, that way the Dark Dwellers dies and he flips his Abyssin and gets rid of all the plants on upkeep. And wow, he actually... Okay.
Oh, okay. Sacrificing the plant. Alright.
Okay. Evil Leap looking for card. That's West Vale. Oh, and he actually tops deck and gets an Abyssin from the Evil Leap. So now what happens is Morris's Abyssin will have to flip on upkeep, and what Allen can do is play the Abyssin here and sacrifice the plant during Morris's turn, which makes both Abyssins flip on Allen's upkeep, killing the Dragon Lord Silumgar, which and putting Allen down to 5, and he can swing freely with the Abyssin if Morris does not have anything in hand, and he actually just has lands. So if Allen sees the blade, that's the game.
Yeah, that's right. And so right now, what Allen just has to do is cast his own Abyssin and sacrifice his blade.
And I believe Morris was checking the mana just to be sure. I'm not sure why he's checking the discard pile though.
I'm thinking it's to check how much more gas Allen has for Evolutionary.
I don't think Morris has seen the play yet, but this is definitely game. Taking a while here, and of course Allen's slow rolling this because he does not know that Morris only has lands in hand. Plays right. The Abyssin, it resolves, prices of land.
Oh. He sees the play. And another one.
That's actually a Lambo pacifist, but it will not matter because this is going to be game.
An upkeep?
Just upkeep. Alan asking for the triggers. They both resolve. Kills up Silumbar. He gets the Abyssin. They go to 5 and 2. And he he's going to swing. Morris, I believe, just double checking if this is indeed what happens. Because this is the game.
I forgot that Abzin was.
And there's the hand!
And wow.
We're now go and that's a game. Alan wins with green white tokens, and we'll be going to one of our semifinal matches next. Make sure to tune in.